This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory,
glory, glory.
Oh,
hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walked through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground. The camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure.
Good morning. Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You know my voice already. It's Leyvon Miller. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you so much for letting me join you. I don't know what it is that you do at 11 o'clock, whatever it is that you do, though. I'm happy that you're doing that, and that you're doing it with me. There are some things I want to talk about this morning. News and current events. The lines are open. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. You can text me at 422-4796. I'll say it again because I know you're going to say I say it too fast, although I say it every day. The numbers 323-6232-325-4316, 325-4259. You can call me on any one of those. You can text me on 422-4796. I want to say this early. I intend to talk to the PLP today. So if you know a PLP under the sound of my voice, wherever he may be in this archipelago, from Inagua in the south all the way up to Grand Key in the north, tell him to tune in because I have a message for the PLP today, right? I'm talking to the PLP today. But before I do that, I have some other things that I want to get off of my chest. I want to talk about the fact that this lady has been put on a probation because she had a plea deal before the Supreme Court. And since the court case is over, I think I can offer my opinion. Let me tell you something. I happen to be a father. I think it is interesting, once again, that none of the people that are against violence against women and children have found it necessary to opine on the fact, I haven't heard it as yet, that this woman was given a slap on the wrist. And I'll tell you what's interesting, because I remember in a time not too long before this time, where a grown man was charged with child pornography for a girl that was 17 years old. And I remember that man being given some sort of a plea deal. And I remember the people who claim to be concerned about the rights of women and children going up in arms about the fact that this man had been given a proverbial slap on the wrist. Now, this woman has put in danger the life of four children. And you may say, well, she didn't harm them. You may say she is mentally unstable. Obviously, the court doesn't think she is so mentally unstable that she ought not go to prison because they did not sentence her to a mental facility. she has to go and do counseling, and she has to check back in with the court twice a year as per the article in this newspaper. The court also says that if she somehow doesn't go in accordance with the terms of her probation, then she will be sent to prison for a period of 2 years. So the court, in its wisdom, has not suggested, to me that is, in my understanding, that this woman is so unstable in her mind that she's incapable of upholding law and order. And as a consequence, if she breaches the term of her negotiation, she will be sent to jail. What saddens me, again, and I tell you, all these bunch of woman group, I want to disband them, every single one of them, because they cherry pick in my mind. They were in the Christian Council. They cherry pick so much. It's funny when I watch you people get down on the Christian Council, right? The woman group included, that the Christian Council is a cherry picking bunch. But this is now about the third time that I think very prevalent matters that ought to have enraged the feminist movement, the woman them movement, and all them other movement to have their voices put on the record. So you may argue the woman did nothing to endanger the life of the children. Well, let me show you my disagreement there. These children were taken either from the sanctuary of their neighborhood communities, or on their traverse to or from their place of education, another sanctuary. She obstructed them from doing that under the guise of friendliness, and then she discarded these children miles away from where they lived. Let us just imagine that there was some other crazy person looking to practice or sharpen their skill of pedophilia that then abducted the child again. Could you imagine that the original perpetrator can no longer tell you of the state of the child because she left them somewhere that someone that meant them ill will could actually get them, removing them from their very safe neighborhood? Yet the woman them, none of them I hear making no noise. Not the feminist them, not the nobody them. And I am a parent. And I want to make this abundantly clear. Make no mistake in your heart about this. Be very assured about this, as you are assured that East and West are in two different directions. If by chance the little green man on your shoulder tell you to kidnap some children that belong to Leyvon, you better go pray. Because I assure you, the little green man cannot save you from me. And since we live in a society where this is, I cannot believe this. If this were a man, people would be marching downtown for this. I don't care how crazy or mentally ill people said you were. And she has family. You know, I'm very sad if you're offended. If by chance, the green, he may be green, the blue man, the green man, any little man that sits on your shoulder tells you that you should go kidnap my 6-year-old son, woe will be unto you. We go into court. The two of us could be going to court. And that's where I stand on it. And it's because it is, I don't understand this. You mean not a single day in jail? Not one day? I hear nothing from the people, you know, what they call it, the family hotline over by the social, I hear from them. None of them bunch of psychologists over there who like to talk about behavioral part, I hear from none of them. I didn't read this whole paper. I hear nothing from, and to be added to the number, I ain't hear from the Christian Council. I imagine I will hear from them shortly on this matter. Because if we fail to protect our children, then who in the name of goodness is going to protect them? I tell you now, if you kidnap children that belong to Leyvon Miller, we going to court. You going for kidnapping, I going for not kidnapping. All right? Anyway, that's all I want to say about it. So I cry shame on the woman group them. And it's because you all... I don't know. I don't get it. It behooves me. I'm unable to comprehend it. It makes no sense to me. All right? Now, the next thing I want to talk about is I see Renwood Wells is Renwood Wellsing again. Right? And you know, I said the Renwood Wells effect is to have the ability to stare directly at a camera and then say something that is completely and utterly nonsensical and to not flinch. So Renwood Wells says yesterday that the recent spike in COVID-19 cases is likely linked to the gatherings during Independence Day weekend. All right? I take issue with that. So the spike can't be in relation to the nominations y'all had the other day, where it was but 700 of y'all in a building with no windows. It couldn't have been tied to that. It couldn't have been tied to the fact that the economy is now partially open, and so there are more people moving in more places, interacting with more people, because we're trying to get the economy to spin. And wouldn't it have been smarter to just say, listen, the government has accepted that people will die, and we are trying to rebound the economy while we mitigate that damage, right? It is collateral damage. But this nonsense here is foolishness. So how come when me and my friends get together for a holiday drink, the same friends that I see every day, but how come when we drink during the holiday, we somehow putting up a spike in COVID-19? I want you to stop it, Minister, okay? Stop it. I get into my show. I tell you, I come to talk to the PLP this morning, and so I want you all to call every single PLP under the sound of my voice and make sure that they listen. The next thing I want to talk about is Lovato Donkinson. I really like Lovato Donkinson. I've known him for, Jesus, how old am I? I've known Lovato Donkinson for about as long as I've been able to speak English. And he's a very good guy. Like, he is Mr. Squeaky Clean. If you want a guy that is upstanding and very by the letter, Lovato Donkinson is, in fact, your guy. It saddens me, though. I read this morning in the newspaper, Donkinson hoping to avoid advanced poll chaos of 2017. Here's where I find difficulty. When you are a senior policymaker, when you are the person in the chair, when you are the person that is responsible for the goings-on, you don't have the luxury of hoping. You don't get to wish when you are the policymaker. You don't get to like the rest of us, exercise good-spirited hopefulness. You are the policymaker, Mr. Donkinson. Create a policy that will not lead to, I don't know what that was in 2017. If you voted in the advance poll in 2017, you would know that old women were falling out. Dr. Dwayne Sands was out there fanning people back to life because they stood up in the sun for 5 hours, not a tent in sight, ain't no tree run, nobody got no umbrella. It was absolute chaos and pandemonium, all in an attempt, I contend, to sink Mr. Sheldon Hall. Somebody wanted Sheldon gone and didn't know how to say it. And so I believe that they undercut him, right? And so, Mr. Lovato Donkinson, as much as I like you, I think you're a great guy. I mean, one of the best human beings I have ever met in my entire life. But this hopefulness, let us don't start with that. Okay, the elections are upon us. Let us not start with, I hope. That's just, I mean, you remember like Bekisha Barker who prays that they can get to the domes. Oh, and by the way, I see she's saying now that they won't get to it. So, yes, that's so much for the domes. That's about all I have to say. Anyway, so Candia Dames wrote an article, the National Review. It's kind of long. Stick with me. I'm going to read it. And when I'm done, we will get to talking to the PLP. Call all your PLP friends and tell them, listen, because I'm talking to them this morning. So the National Review says, state of disarray. The government of the Bahamas appears to be running on autopilot as Sorry, let's start again. The government of the Bahamas appears to be running on autopilot as Minnis seems more consumed with winning an election than anything else. His ministers, who have been renominated, are focused on winning their seats once again in an atmosphere of widespread discontent and, in some circles, disgust toward the Minnis administration and the Free National Movement. They have been advised by their leader to stay on the ground as his hand is on the handle of the election bell. The House of Assembly has been adjourned to September 22nd with no expectation that the current parliament will meet again, though the Minnis administration's promised legislative agenda is largely unfulfilled. When the emergency order expires August 13, it is anyone's guess what the government's plan will be for the management of the ongoing COVID pandemic. We do not get a sense that fighting the pandemic is the government's main priority right now. While cases of COVID-19 remain alarmingly high, with 83 people who tested positive hospitalized as of Monday, a total of 274 deaths, and another 22 under investigation, it has been more than 3 months since the Ministry of Health officials have called a press conference to answer questions and provide critically needed information to the public. There have been no reports on whether any variants have been identified in the country, no reports on what is accounting for the spike in cases, no reports on just how many vaccine doses we have left in the country, and no explanation on the science that is behind restrictions that remain in place. On Monday, the Prime Minister very clumsily and inelegantly, declared the pandemic is over for the vaccinated. It was a repeat of what Minnis perhaps heard U.S. President Joseph Biden state recently, as Biden himself echoed comments that were made by Dr. Rochelle Walensky, director of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. The CDC, however, advises travelers returning to the United States from international destinations to get tested 3 to 5 days after international travel, and travelers into the United States are still required to get tested prior to leaving international destinations. That is because vaccinated individuals can still contract COVID and spread it. While the comments of the American officials speak to cases of COVID-19, hospitalizations, and death being primarily among unvaccinated population, Minnis ought to be careful in the message he is sending. His statement was highly irresponsible and poorly informed. It is not complete information. He should speak to his healthcare officials before he makes these kinds of statements so he can put information out in its proper context. The statement demonstrated a lack of true rigor and thought process. Minnis is likely only angering and isolating more Bahamians pitting the vaccinated against the unvaccinated when he knows that even if all adults in the Bahamas wanted to get vaccinated, his government has no means of making that possible. There is a big difference between the Bahamas and the United States. The Bahamas government only has a handful of vaccines left and has stopped offering first doses. In the United States, all individuals interested in getting vaccinated have easy access to vaccines. Another 33,600 doses of the AstraZeneca vaccine are expected in the Bahamas next week, officials say. Under 10% of the population is vaccinated, the new doses will only be enough to fully vaccinate 20,000 who need second doses and another 7,000 or so individuals who need first and second doses. We presume the government will have to subtract 5,000 doses to give back to Antigua and Barbuda for the doses it recently borrowed, but again, details on that arrangement were never provided to the public, and officials only acknowledge they, it carries on to L2, had to borrow doses after the Nassau Guardian reported it. Minister of Health Renwood Wells last week said, the Bahamas will receive 57,330 doses of the Pfizer vaccine through the COVAX facility, but was unable to say when. As the vaccine shortage remains critical, the government does not seem to have a sense of urgency over increasing COVID deaths and a worsening crisis in the healthcare system, which is on the brink of collapse, according to the healthcare professionals struggling to keep it together. The effort to save lives appears to be taking a backseat as there is an election to win. In recent days, the Prime Minister has also adopted a new narrative, declaring the Bahamian economy is roaring back to life. The economy is certainly showing important signs of progress as major resorts are reporting high occupancy levels. The cruise business has restarted on a very limited basis, and some Bahamians have returned to work after being furloughed for months during the pandemic. But there is nothing to support Minister's statement that the economy is roaring. Speaking on Monday, the Prime Minister insisted, "We have a plan. We are sticking to the plan. That is why from January to June of 2021, we beat our revenue projections for the six-month period. That is why for the month of July up to last Friday, July 16th, our revenues are tracking ahead of budgetary projections for month to date as our economy roars back to life. We doubt, however, the average business person in the Bahamas is seeing signs of a roaring economy, and we certainly doubt the average Bahamian is feeling the benefits of a roaring economy. Ask the residents of Grand Bahama if they are witnessing this roaring economy that they are likely to tell you, no, they are not. Those who still stand in line to get food assistance on New Providence and elsewhere know not of which Prime Minister Minister speaks. Minister's only making a feeble attempt to convince voters into believing that his stewardship of the economy has been successful throughout his term in office and that somehow his policies throughout this COVID period have had some success around rebuilding the economy, none of which is true. The economy in 2021 is expected to record modest growth according to the Central Bank of the Bahamas. The Prime Minister is engaged in election talk, appears prone to exaggeration, and living in a dream world as he tries to convince us that he is fit for another term. Minister has said the next term will be about the poor. In opposition, he also promised that if elected, he would focus on making life better for the poor. But the poor have borne the brunt of tax increases, which Minister's administration said were unavoidable. This week, we heard Minister promise that if re-elected, he would not raise taxes. But who really believes him? This is the same Minister who in opposition condemned the Christie administration when it introduced value-added tax, calling it lazy and unimaginative approach, a lazy and unimaginative approach to addressing our fiscal woes. It's the same Minister who, within a year of gaining power, raised VAT from 7.5% to 12%. This is the same Minister who repeatedly promised in opposition that his administration would put in place a fixed election date if elected, but now seemingly enjoys reminding us all that he is the only one as Prime Minister who is able to call an election, and no one should listen to the speculation of opposition leader Philip Brave Davis. If Minister was serious about this fixed election day pledge, he would by now have announced to the public when the election will be called. Instead, he is playing a cat and mouse game with the Bahamian people regarding when the election is going to be held. The Prime Minister should also be concerned that the speculation is leading to large crowds outside voter registration centers. The country is on edge in wait to learn the election date. On July 4th, Minister urged Bahamians to register to vote in the soonest time possible. Last Tuesday, he gave FNM candidates their marching orders, and on Thursday, the party completed ratifying its candidates. The increased election odds the FNM is running is also a sure sign that the Prime Minister is getting set to call an election. The debacle surrounding the presentation of the Constituencies Commission report to the Governor General has also weighed on the public, further underscoring a democracy in disarray and highlighting the unlikelihood of Minister wanting to spend any more time dealing with a speaker who has been a thorn in his side for the last 2 years. We are today a rudderless nation in urgent need of a reset. Our government appears more obsessed with photo ops than with outlining and executing any meaningful initiatives to move the needle and drive the national progress. The abuse of the public trust, the mismanagement of our affairs, the failure to be transparent on matters of national importance, and the hypocrisy repeatedly demonstrated by Minister and others in his administration have resulted in a complete depletion of the goodwill with which they came to office. With credibility eroded, it is difficult for the government to govern effectively in the absence of a new mandate. Notwithstanding the Prime Minister's repeated declarations about a booming economy, which we are likely to hear repeated today when he participates in the ribbon cutting of the Margaritaville Hotel at The Point, there remains a lot of uncertainty. High vaccine hesitancy and the critical shortage of vaccines contribute to that uncertainty. As we opened extensively last week, it appears Minnis is banking on the unattractiveness of Davis, the Progressive Liberal Party's leader, to scrape another victory. But many Bahamians are anxious to get rid of Minnis and the FNM from office, notwithstanding their misgivings about Davis and the PLP. It is against that backdrop of unfulfilled pledges, uninspiring leadership, and disdain toward the Bahamian people that we will head to the polls sooner rather than later. We expect a short sprint to election day, as the Prime Minister has already advised his party candidates. Many are anxious for the opportunity to deliver their verdict on Minnis and the FNM. Whichever side emerges victorious come election night, there will be no time for a honeymoon, as our national problems are so grave that the next administration will have a task more serious than any other administration since our independence. With our political leaders more concerned with winning than governing, the disarray we are currently experiencing is likely to continue long after the last ballot is counted. And after having read that, Kermit, I decided that I want to awaken the spirit of PLPs everywhere.
The sun on my face. See the light at the end of the tunnel. And I can feel heaven in this place. And that's the sign of a victory. That's the sign of a victory. The nations, and I can feel my wings riding the wind. Yeah, I see the finish line just up ahead now, and I can feel the rising deep within, and that's the sign of a victory. Mm-hmm. That's the sign of a victory. Now I can see the distance of your journey, and how you fought with all your might. You open your eyes to global warming, and through it all, you sacrificed your life. That's the sign of a victory. Yeah, yeah. That's the sign of a victory. Yes, I know. So let's lift up our heads, yeah. And raise the flag, yeah, yeah. Scream like you're born to win. Now let the game begin. That's the sign of a victory. Yeah. That's the sign of a victory. Yeah. That's the sign of a victory. Whoa, whoa, whoa. That's the sign of a victory. When you keep on riding.
So hopefully every single PLP in the Bahamas is awake now, because I'll tell you what I've come to notice. It seems to me as though the PLP's political machinery is falling asleep. I don't need the people that are hired to call the talk shows to talk to me. I want to talk to some people that are not the PLP call-ins. I am not convinced that the PLP is working hard enough to win the next general election. I believe that the PLP imagines they will win this election through cosmosis, right? And I think that that would be a fatal mistake of the Progressive Liberal Party.
You can call me if you disagree. 323-623-2323-254-316-325-4259, right? Here's why I make that assessment. The campaign seems to have fallen flat, right? There are seats that were on the easily winnable category for the Progressive Liberal Party that I no longer think they enjoy, right? I think everybody wanted Bamboo Town gone. I mean Renwood Wells. But yet, I don't think the PLP can comfortably suggest that their candidate and the campaign strategy has materialized in that way. People are actually, believe this or not, still talking about Renwood Wells. Can you believe it? I don't think the Progressive Liberal Party has moved their feet swiftly enough in Bairntown. And so while a predominantly PLP seat, the talk about Travis Robinson holding on to Bairntown still exists. There's also places like North Abaco. I imagined that the FNM would not even be able to raise their heads in North Abaco. But I think the candidate for North Abaco is flat-footed and just doesn't posture well. You don't feel him. You don't see him. None of the people from Abaco that I know and speak with know anything about him in a way that makes them convinced that they want him to be their member of parliament. And when someone that is around the news as much as Candia Dames is, someone that has had at least 20 years now in following politics as closely as Candia Dames has, someone that has had an opportunity to actually claim that she's upseated governments. You, PLPs blame Candia Dames for what happened to the PLP, right? And if that is so, then how is it that someone that Candia Dames makes the claim, and I quote, "We are today a rudderless nation in urgent need of a reset," but that is not exactly what I hear on the ground. It is interesting that even when the chairman of the Progressive Liberal Party decides that he is going to do a video from Grand Bahama in the front of the building that the Free National Movement haven't finished, and I know what they will say, it was a pandemic and they had Dorian, right? They couldn't, they didn't have the money. But the five candidates that are there largely focus on rhetoric, and there is no real substance in this 7 minutes and 36 seconds. And I use my data to watch this. They seem more like rabble rousers than actual well-oiled soldiers ready for a political battle. They remind me of the Athenians, you know, and not very much of the Spartans. They seem like men with sticks and rakes and shovels, not men with shield and sword. And so I think if the Progressive Liberal Party is going to be serious about winning an election, we already know that we have great difficulty with being able to swallow Mr. Davis. He is actually not palatable to some Bahamians. And not without good cause. We remember Bamzi. We remember the disarray with Ministry of Works and contracts. And we remember the LOI. And Mr. Davis had oversight over all of that. I don't need the PLP call-ins to call me. I think you all should not call so that y'all could let some other people help y'all convince themselves why they should pick y'all. But I think this is something that is very concerning. And I think that is something that the Progressive Liberal Party ought to spend some time and attention on. The ads have fallen flat. And not the one with Brave Davis growing up poor. No one cares. He's one of the richest people around this place. No one still believes Brave poor or that the things that were a part of his poorness as a child still affects his life today. No one believes that. As a matter of fact, y'all should walk away from that narrative. We know the dude got plenty money. There's no harm in being rich, you know. Being rich ain't like a pandemic. Well, it's obviously not a pandemic because other than Brave, I didn't go LeBron and maybe Brent Simonette and Hubert Minnis. Nobody else got money. The rest of these dudes broke. Right? So it's obviously not a pandemic. But there is no stigma to being rich. So lose that nonsense and actually come out here with some policy that gets people thinking and talking about the PLP. Anyway, that's enough of my voice. Let's hear what you all have to say. 323-623-2323-254-316-325-4259. Let's go to the phone lines, Cameron. Good morning, caller. You're on. Caller, you there?
Hey, I'm Leyvon. How are you?
I'm great.
Great. Beautiful song.
I hope you like it.
Love it. You know what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
I don't agree with.
Sure.
100%. Yes, there is room for huge improvements across the board. Okay, but to say that, but I guess you don't see it. It's obvious you're not a PLP.
Okay.
Right, and as far as the average the PLP voters and the psyche of a PLP the PLP electorate.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, yesterday I couldn't call you yesterday.
Okay.
I listened to you yesterday, what you said in reference to but the situation, you know, yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
But campaigns and on the ground and the way you go about campaigning, you know there are different ways. Sorry about that. You know there are different ways and there are different methods, and you have to change up your style sometimes.
Sure.
Right? I watched the same tape that you watched in Grand Bahama.
Mm-hmm.
And to those persons in Grand Bahama who those persons were speaking to,
mm-hmm.
I'm sure they understood what those persons were saying.
Okay.
Okay? So I think the majority of them. Now, yes, you have some candidates. They have to pick it up. They have to get on, you know, really get in there and do what they have to do.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But I've seen that. I have been, and because I was one who was very discouraged about 4 years ago.
Okay.
With this party. Very, very discouraged. I had my concerns about Mr. Davis as a leader, right? But they have shown me from over the last couple of years, they've shown me, when you see a party that people had buried, they already celebrate, they already start to walk away
mm-hmm.
from the grave, the PRP's grave.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? When you see people, the leadership of the party actually organize, they have to build that party back up from partially scratch. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
For them to get to the point where they're at now, see, a lot of people, they can't say these are the same old people.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at the face of the candidates, when you look at the candidates themselves, right? They're basically new. That's a whole new party.
But do we want rabble rousers? Because if you look at the face of the FNM as it presently stands, this is a new party as well. And we saw that in the pandemic, that didn't benefit us any at all. Why? Because those people were largely unknown and largely didn't have the experience. So a new face, right, is wonderful. But do we have new faces with new ways of thinking, but people who also have access to people of influence in a way that if something happened, if something went awry in government, we are able to use the collateral of these people that we bring with their new faces?
Right, you see, but that's what I'm saying is persons were using that, and that was for a time. A Candia Dames and many others had said that. That was one of the things that they said.
Mm-hmm.
The same old, right? And I just used that one example to you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, you can have the questions asked, but this government has done with their new faces.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they choose not to utilize their new faces or their new faces messed up, right? Or what didn't do what they were supposed to. That's on them.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the same token, but given this, all of the parties that are trying, the opposing party,
mm-hmm.
who want hush an opportunity
mm-hmm.
to, you know, offer themselves as to show what they're worth. You can only go and you can only entrust based on what you see, what you want, the questions that you ask as far as their plan.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, that the certain plans that the PRP, their things are dropping flat. They may drop flat to you and others, but some persons who the things that they're talking about, the economic plans, these different things that they have brought forward to the public.
Mm-hmm.
It may not be because some people you can be the dead horse and overlap, but some people they hearing you. Period. They see this the PLP and they're not. I am done and I don't want to hear it.
Okay.
Right.
But if that's the
PLP base, and I can assure you,
mm-hmm.
the majority the base. Of the PLP, once that is intact, once the PLP base could remain intact, the first thing is to get your base back. Once you can get that base intact,
mm-hmm.
you understand me?
I feel you. And I'll tell you this. I'll tell you what I believe. I believe that that is a game of Russian roulette. The PLP suffers from lackadaisical behavior at this time in my mind. When you all had aspirants, I have to admit, I thought the PLP, I say, boy, the PLP look good. Every time I click a button, only thing I could see is PLP shade in the community, PLP this thing doing the next thing, PLP having talking points on the Now it all seems to have fallen flat. What, like, what is the candidate in North Abaco doing? I know. I know when y'all had aspirin race, man, they did look real good down there. I saw Miss Penn down there having a blast. What is the PLP's candidate? Do you know what I consider effective political marketing? I went into, and I'm just going to call the name. I went into Garden Hills the other day. Golden Gates. And I met a guy who I do not associate with competence or news at all. Like, I don't imagine that he knows which day of the week it is. But I know him. We grew up together. I don't know where he's gone, but he has obviously vacated his past self. And we got into a little chit-chat. And he's like, well, I really ain't into this election stuff. La, 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 la. Matter of fact, only really one person I see, look, are they doing anything? That's the, what the woman named? The Pia woman. And for me, that blew me out of the water because I thought to myself, this boy don't read no newspaper, right? Like, I sure his phone don't have no data on it. Nothing. As a matter of fact, he probably still have a bubbler because he's one of them people that believe that they're trying to program you for world domination with smartphones, right? So I don't suspect that he is read or aware. But the fact that he knows the candidate is interesting to me because if the message get to him, then obviously the candidate in that constituency is doing a good job. And my question to you, if you are a PLP candidate now, is that where you are in your candidacy or campaign or on the ground game? Because if you're not, if we are still contemplating your ability, boy, I think you're putting the PLP in a hard spot. But that's just me. Let's take another one. Good morning, caller. You're on. Is the call there? Not there. Next call. Good morning, caller. You're on. Give me a call back. 3236233. Hey.
Good morning, how you doing?
I feel good.
Man, you got some people. I really wish, Leyvon, that they become nationalists and not color people. I need you to help me here.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to look out your window and I want you to see that brand new plane out there,
mm-hmm.
747 out there, named Progressive Liberal Body. You
mm-hmm.
see it?
Mm-hmm. It's a
brand new plane, Leyvon.
Brand new 747.
Yeah, okay. We might as well pack our bikes and get on board, eh?
Okay.
But guess what, Leyvon? Look who fly in the plane. Look who's the captain and the co-pilot.
Mm-hmm.
Brave Davis and Fred Mitchell. Brand new plane, you know.
Yeah.
But they got the same mindset in the front. Has Brave Davis and Fred Mitchell addressed this nation in 4 years yet?
I don't know, but I will tell you this. I heard the last caller talking about the base. I feel like you ain't got to convince PLVs to be PLVs, right? But you need to convince me because right now I'm a political bastard, you know. You know, I always tell people, I is an I for Tanya FNM. I shout that from the mountaintop. So you can't say I anti-FNM, right? But right now, politically, I am a bastard child. So you need to come convince me. And I don't think they're doing that.
Yeah, they ain't sitting down and critically thinking about it. Yes, the PLP, Chester Cooper too, will, so if they was to win, will succumb to the party constitution. They'll probably take him and throw him under the bus too. That's how they do everybody else. These PLPs and FNMs got to realize who fly in this plane. It's mm-hmm. the same mindset. I don't care how brand new the plane is.
Mm.
You understand me?
Mm-hmm.
But thanks for taking the call.
Appreciate your text right here. Says the PLP has the exact same problem as the FNM. They have no message because there's no imagination or vision about the future. Why would anyone in their right mind vote for the FNM? There is no case that they can make. Their record is screaming at you. And that is why they have a theme like it is about your future. This is similar to the Christie problem in 2017 with Stronger Bahamas. His record was screaming, to win an election, you need to activate people's imagination. In 2017, it's the people's time. 2012, believe in Bahamians. Today, we want a new Bahamas. Bahamas 2.0 and a reimagined country without the politician and political parties at the center. Let me get a couple of these text messages. And this one here says, if my child get kidnapped, I could assure you I will raise hell. Yes, hell with three L's. That's how crazy I would be. Don't kidnap none of my... Tell the little green man on your shoulder. Mm-mm, that's Leyvon boy. Don't fool with that. Mr. Miller, you was reading my mind. Only in the Bahamas. Hi, I hope these candidates see the hell people go through just to vote for them so they can crease up in the Queen's House of Assembly. Hi, Leyvon. I blame weak political correct men like you who pushed the gender equality BS. You obviously don't know anything about me, text writer. She got away easy because she is a woman and her victims were little boys. But we all know what happened would have happened if the perpetrator was a man and the victims were little girls. I hear my music. That means I'm going to a break. Some of y'all talk show hosts are really jokey. We are far better off than many countries around the world. The facts are the economy is returning back faster than all predictions. The FNM was not perfect, but they did a fair job of managing this COVID crisis and reopening the economy. Anyway, don't move. I'm going to a break. Leyvon Miller. We'll be back.
In life, there are always challenges. Today, we find ourselves having to be more self-sufficient, socially aware, and technically savvy. At J.S. Johnson, we are committed to our customers by providing cost-effective insurance solutions. No matter what your insurance needs, we will always be here for you. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com. J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers, giving you peace of mind.
Morning Blend Business.
The economy.
Finance.
Business.
Industry.
Government sector.
Private sector.
Financial services.
Tourism.
Personal finance.
Investing advice.
Consumer issues. Consumer rights.
Trends and business opportunities.
Morning Blend Business. Following Morning Blend every weekday from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. right here on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Text writer says, the fact that most of our leaders, while campaigning, think it's critical to portray themselves as deriving from a poor legacy indicates two things. Firstly, they must think the Bahamians are jaded toward wealthy Bahamians. Secondly, their lack of wanting to address this, I don't know what that word says, nationally, so that we are not a people that seek to punish the wealthy but get busy ourselves to self-actualization. This one here says, come on, Leyvon, how many new FNMs 5 years ago had claim to fame? A couple, Dionisio Diagola, Marvin D. Do you know what else is interesting? You know, last election, the FNM was advertising ministerial positions. Imagine Jeffrey Lloyd as our next Minister of Education. Imagine the crime wave, Marvin Deans, the next Minister of... You notice they ain't giving out no premature cabinet appointments, right? I believe that that all-star cabinet, that right there, that kill Hubert Minister, I'm telling you. Hey, Leyvon, that plane ain't a new plane, and the plane ain't going nowhere. Let's try another one. Hey, Leyvon, I live in 8 Mile Rock area. People were crying for someone to speak up on the government complex and the school in Holmes' Rock, and members of the PLP answered the call. So we are grateful to them. Okay, that's fine. I watched the video, though. It makes me cringe a little bit. Mr. Miller, nothing that I voted for the FNM in general... What does this say? Mr. Miller... Nothing that I voted for the FNM for in the 2017 general election they have done. I'm FNM, but will not be voting for them this go round. All unfulfilled promises, no term limits for the prime minister, no fixed election dates, no freedom of information. And on top of that, a PM who is borderline dictatorial. I actually am very glad that you said that, text writer, because I want to read this little article to you. I think I have about 7 minutes left. I want to read this article to you that I actually pulled from 2016. And it was after the We March, and this is what got me thinking that the PLP was being kind of lazy, because the FNM somehow crafted the whole We March movement. And guess what? They actually get me to be a part of that. Not they themselves, but I was actually in the room at the inaugural meeting of We March, believing that this was something about country. And I'm actually going to get them the first set of black card papers, and I challenge somebody to say I lie. But I just want to read this, where Mr. Minnis, it says here, let's start from the beginning. Opposition leader Dr. Hubert Minnis said last Friday, We March Bahamas protest has opened his eyes and he is now a different change leader. In an interview with the Tribune, Dr. Minnis said, the people want a new type of leader who will listen to them and take action. He said, this is the people's time, and vowed that if elected prime minister during the upcoming election, he will follow the instructions of the people. And then VAT went up. The Kalani MP also chastised Prime Minister Perry Christie for failing to show up at the march and attempting to arrange a secret meeting with the organizers. That's when I knew they wasn't serious and stopped fooling with them. On Friday, hundreds of Bahamians took to the streets to protest against the government for its ineffective management of the country's affairs. Promoted as a silent protest, the event began at Arawaki at 1 p.m. with an estimate of up to 1,000 people gathering at the meeting point. Dressed in all black, protesters faithfully marched from Arawaki to Rawson Square without incident, occasionally singing the Bahamian national anthem and chanting things like, the power of the people is better than the people in power. Many of the protesters occupied Rawson Squares until 1 a.m. Saturday. The people are frustrated and the people are tired, Dr. Minnis said yesterday. The march was not just a march against the Progressive Liberal Party. It was against the government as a whole and against politicians. They were saying, this is what we want. Listen to us. Enough is enough. They want a new type of politician and want the same old way to stop. I will be different. I will be a different type of leader. The protests opened my eyes. I will listen to my employer and do what is right for the Bahamian people. This is the people's time, and I will listen to what they have to say. Dr. Minnis said he does not blame protest organizer, I don't call that name in public, for not wanting to meet with Mr. Christie. Last Tuesday, that guy issued a list of 23 nonpartisan demands to Mr. Christie and several other government ministers. Mr. Christie, in a 5-page statement on Thursday, said he was painfully aware that the country has suffered tremendous setbacks and invited the group to meet. However, on Friday, that fella said he had no intentions on meeting with the prime minister at the ninth hour, which is when I knew they wasn't serious. He also said the organizers of the protest would meet with the nation's leader once their demands were met. The people don't want secret meetings. They want action, Dr. Minnis said. They don't want to talk to our prime minister. Why can't I read this? They don't want to talk. And our prime minister is nothing but a talker. All he does is have secret meetings and secret deals in dark rooms and have secret contracts. That is why they don't want to meet with Mr. Christie. I don't think he understands the purpose of the march. The people are frustrated and the government is acting as if they are employers as opposed to employees. Mr. Christie has a record of not listening to people, but that will not be me. Organizers of the protest have promised to stage a similar event on Majority Rule Day if the government does not meet their demands. All right, so you see that nothing in there was the truth either. Let's take one more call. Good morning, caller. You're on. Those are the words of Hubert Minnis, by the way. I almost rolled over laughing reading it. Caller, you're on. Not there. Next line. Good morning, caller. You're on.
Hello.
Hey.
How are you doing?
I feel good.
Now, let me tell you, Mr. Mandela, you dealing with a fella from Arkansas Island.
Mm-hmm.
Snuck on Arkansas Island.
Mm-hmm.
Eliza Orlando Ferguson.
Okay.
A former police officer.
Mm-hmm.
And a justice of the peace.
Okay.
Now, let me tell you something. Brave Davis, speak less, and think the most. Mr. Minnis is a goddamn joke. Excuse me.
That is Mr. Eliezer Orlando Ferguson, and he from Snug Gone Acklands, y'all. All right? Anyway, let me get... Boy, I don't know. They tell me the candidate for my car look good. She seated well. 64 votes minimum, Kermit. That's what they say. Hi, Leyvon. I don't believe in many of Minnis's policies and disagree with having Renwood Wells as Minister of Health. That was like putting a pyromaniac in charge of a fire department. He could only wreak havoc up in there. However, Minnis is best right now to continue to lead this country. Okay. This here says, but leaving the caller criticized Fred. Fred is the best in international affairs. Look at how he addressed the U.S.-China row. Great show, Mr. Miller. Elections are won in the Bahamas by the party with the best machinery. The electorate in the Bahamas do not understand what is responsibility of an MP, which is to be a legislator. I completely agree with that. And I want to say right now, the PLP ain't acting like the SSPLP. I can't hear the engines. Last one before I get out here. I agree with you. Andres is in trouble as well. The person who was campaigning for the last 3 years was thrown under the bus. I waking up PLP, Skirmit. Was thrown under the bus, and the people are rejecting the candidate who was sent. Brave need to give the people what they want. He will lose the seat. So to my PLP friends everywhere, hopefully this week, all y'all up and y'all get the machinery cranking started, all right? That's my time. I'm Leyvon Miller. Well, this is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, your station for fresh news and smart talk. News is next.
Glory, oh, glory, glory.
Hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon. Formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtapositioning us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisited.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9.